Where does our culture come from? When we talk about culture, that is that stuff that sits in the organization outside of projects and tasks and people. It's our informal norms that tell us how we should behave and communicate, etc. So culture is really the way we do things around here. Culture is hard to change because it really starts with the founder of the organization. So he or she have certain values and preferences, and we see them through their behaviors, their actions, how they talk, how they walk, what they spend their time on. This is internal to the organization, right? So these are internal factors that are now impacting what kind of culture we're gonna have. And when these values and preferences cause the founder and the team maybe around the founder, top managers, bosses, whatever, the new employees, when they cause this organization to be successful, it sticks. So these things that work will actually stick in the culture and become the culture. Of course, no organization lives in a bubble. We are in a certain industry, and this industry is external to us, right? So we have internal factors, we also have external factors. So the industry we're in puts demands on us, and we respond to these demands. And when we are successful in responding, meaning we are providing what our clients want, we have a good relationship with our vendor, etc., again, they will stick in the culture. The things that work well for us, we're going to keep them around. So a culture is shaped by both external and internal factors and challenges. And when we successfully adapt to what goes on around us, we will keep those values. And we talk a lot about just values when we talk about culture. These are really what's important to us. And what's important to us can show up as behaviors, actions, communications, etc. So we talk about values a lot, but it means something broader than that. And so these values and ways then become how we do business. And when we bring in new people, new employees, they learn it as well. So this is how we create culture. This is culture creation. Once we have a created culture, we actually also maintain it, right? So now we actually maintain the culture. And we do it in four different ways. These different ways are actually pretty broad, right? Attraction, selection, attrition is the first framework. I'm going to talk about that one in with Google as an example on the next slide. We have onboarding, we have leadership, and we have reward systems, all of which are very, very broad. And together, they end up in our organizational culture being maintained. So let's start with number two, and then we'll finish with number one, ASA. Onboarding is really what happens when an employee comes on board, are employed, and enters into an organization to do work. Sometimes we call it socialization. It means that the employee learns about the business, both about what needs to be done. Maybe there's knowledge and skills about how to do their work. They learn about vision and mission. They learn about how we communicate, right? So they learn attitudes and behaviors in addition to tasks and knowledge. So they learn both the soft side as well as the functional work side of things. We might do this through formal programs. We might have you go through a four-day intro course. You might be watching videos online about the company. You might have certain mentors that you're paired up with. So there's a number of ways that the organizations can do this formally. And we can do it informally as well, because you might be talking to people during the lunch break and you learn about the company that way. So as an employee, this is a good opportunity for you to seek out feedback, ask questions. It's better to do it in your first 3 months when people know you're a newbie. If you're still doing it in year two and year four, it might look a little bit different, right? So seek out feedback, talk to people, try to get information about how things are working, what you're doing well, what you could do better. Be open to the feedback, and that's going to help you be more successful in that role, in that company. We also have leaders, right? Bosses and managers. Again, both formal ways of them doing maybe performance evaluations, coaching, etc. But also their informal behaviors and their communications. Where do they spend their time? Who do they talk to? In meetings, what do they focus on? All of those things is role modeling for us. We see what they think is important, we pay attention to it, and we follow along. So leaders really have a big, big, big impact on how culture is created as well as how it's maintained. Number four is our reward systems. Informal systems such as who gets to go to lunch with the boss, right? That's FaceTime with the boss. That's a cool thing. We kind of want that. But also formal systems. Is it merit-based? Is it seniority-based? Do you measure behaviors or results? What is being focused on? The reward systems are very important in organizations because we pay attention to what we get rewarded for, and then we do more of that. So if you want me to be competitive, we are a sales organization, and aggressive with my clients because you reward me on every sale, well, then that's what's going to happen. So pay attention to what kind of reward system are in your organization, and is it really getting you the type of behaviors and actions you want? All of this together, whoop, that's going to be your organizational culture. And we feed this organizational culture every day through our behaviors and through our communications. We feed it. Okay, jumping now to the first point, which was attraction, selection, and attrition. This is a framework that says that you are attracted to an organization and you want to work for them, right? So whatever reason you're attracted to them. So you might be attracted to Google because you're a computer scientist and you want to be part of writing code for this humongous organization. That's a good fit probably, and Google probably want to hire you too, right? But there's a lot of people who are applying to work for Google for a number of other reasons, right? So this little image here tells us that they get lots and lots of resumes every year and they hire only a small percentage. Now, don't quote me on this number exactly right now, but the point of this image here is just to say we don't hire everybody who apply. And this little joke right here, it's actually just saying that you don't even need to submit your resume because Google already knows everything about us. It's a joke, right? To some extent. So, some other people might also be attracted to Google because of the perks, right? You want to hang out there because of their beautiful cafeteria, because of the cool environments, the bicycles on campus, etc. And that would not be a good fit for Google, right? We don't want to just hire people because of the perks that they are wanting to have. So at that point, the second component of the ASA framework kicks in, right? That's the selection. So if you are a PhD in computer science, you're probably likely to be selected into Google, right? Or higher likelihood. But if you're only looking to go there for their perks, unlikely to get selected. And if you then by chance get hired on, then we have something called attrition at the end. So if it ends up being that they hire this computer scientist, and the computer scientist happens to live in Sacramento and not down in whatever, Redwood City, or wherever Google has its headquarters, right? the company might terminate this PhD because she always shows up late and she's tired from that long commute, you know, in normal times. Or it could be that the computer scientist decides that the commute is not even worth it. And so that they have attrition, meaning they decide to separate or exit from Google. And we call that attrition. So I don't have super pretty handwriting, but you can tell what I'm saying here just by my words as well. And I'm hoping that you can hear them, right? So attraction, you're attracted to the organization, you apply, the organization may or may not select you, and then you may stay. In that case, there's no attrition, or there might be attrition, meaning you leave the organization and you might leave it because of your choice or because of the organization's choice. And so that is it for ASA, for how we actually maintain culture in an organization. That's it. Good luck. Talk to you next time.